GOP nominee. But first, a new report looks at how digital devices are taking a toll on kids and families. The report issued yesterday by Common Sense Media found half of all young people feel they are addicted to their devices. Almost 60% of adults think their kids are addicted too. And a third of parents and teens say they argue daily about screen time. Now, a new documentary explores this topic and offers ideas about what families might do to navigate these waters. William Brangham is back with our look.
The documentary is called Screenagers, and in it, Dr. Delaney Rustin explores the complex relationship teenagers have with their screens, both the pleasures they take in sharing their lives online with their friends, as well as the darker side, those who lose control of their digital habits and spiral into damaging behavior.
When I went to hug him, I could feel the bones in his back, and that was scary.
The film also looks at the latest research about the impact all this screen time has on the brains of young people.
You have a brain that is wired for what in psychology is called seeking behavior, the kind of thing that a Google search gives you, something new, something stimulating, something different.
Throughout the film, Rustin also turns the camera on herself, exploring the real and all too common conflicts that flare up as she and her family haggle over screen time.
What should the rules be? Because we don't have any right now.
I think the rules should be there is no rules. It's not like I'm on it 24/7.
When you had it, you're always checking it. And I don't you think that it...
Well, if you put this in front of me, yes, I will go on it. And yes, I can find something to do on it.
Tessa, why are you so mad?
Okay, just get dressed. I'm sorry you're crying.
I met with Delaney Rustin last week in Washington, D.C. I wonder what was it that initially, what made you want to do this film?
I was having a really hard time as a mom with my two kids. You know, my son wanted to play video games a lot, and my daughter really wanted more and more social media, and I felt completely out of control. And as a doctor, I was thinking, what is the impact of all this screen time? I knew as a mom that every day there was tension in the house, and that I felt completely out of control on what to do, what kind of limits to set, how this was affecting them.
Now that you have done all this research, what was it, I'm curious, that most surprised you that you found?
Well, I think one thing that really helped me to start to be a better parent around this is to learn that the dopamine that's secreted in the brain's pleasure center when we get new bits of information and we look at the screens, that center of the brain is most activated when we're kids and we're teenagers. So knowing that they are so pulled into these in a way that we can't even understand has made me not be as angry at them, but realize there's a lot more I need to do as in my parenting.
So these are little electronic drug delivery devices. I know that's a crude way to put it, but that's what you're saying.
Absolutely. I mean, it's amazing that there's many studies that look at MRI scans of the brain of kids who play a lot of video games, 20 hours or more of video games a week. And when they compared them to people who are addicted to, say, drugs or alcohol, their brain scans are similar. So something is really happening on a physiological level. It's not just psychological.
We exposed young mice to switching sounds and lights.
In the film, Rustin talks with researchers who are studying what multitasking, switching rapidly back and forth between digital devices, does to the brain function of mice.
Afterwards, we looked at the effect on learning and found that the ability of these young mice to learn new things was very much compromised. It took them 3 times longer or more to learn how to go through a maze than the non-exposed young mice.
We're exposing a whole generation of children to these rapid-paced media, and we have no clue what it does to the brain. And if it's the same as we see in the mice, then this is a very shocking news.
But does that kind of stuff terrify you, or do you think this research is not necessarily analogous? I mean, how are people supposed to process that information?
You know, I think it's a question about how much we're giving kids full potential in everything that they do. And to me, a big issue is about how much time they have with all sorts of skills that they're learning offline. Social engagement, competency, talking to people face to face. I think if we're giving them a lot of those situations, that even if there's some concern about attention span and possibly some changes in the brain, I think the humans are resilient enough, and already we're seeing people are not, you know, dropping like flies from screen time. I don't think we're at a place yet where we need to be really alarmist.
Let's say I'm a parent and I come to you and I say, I have a young kid, maybe a 10-year-old daughter. When should I get her a phone? What would you tell this parent?
I think, you know, obviously every kid is different, and that's really important, and every situation in the home is different. But I do worry that it is getting younger and younger. And when we bring them, start having them in elementary school, we have to wonder, when is it too young that they're not going to be able to resist the impulse to check or to post?
Every girl in the picture is locked into her phone. Peralta knocks it into center. David tonight, 2 for 2, a leadoff single here in the fourth. And nobody noticed. Can we do an intervention?
This is all about teaching kids self-control. And what we've learned through the research is that it's absolutely teachable. So I would really discourage a family from getting a child a device when they don't feel like they're going to be able to control themselves from when they use it.
Kids are constantly distracted.
Rustin has been taking her film across the country recently, holding screenings in dozens of cities, encouraging parents and kids to come, to watch, and then to continue the conversation at home.
You know what I think is really exciting is that kids and teenagers actually want to talk about these issues. And I think that it doesn't take that long in homeroom or in some other setting to ask these questions about, you know, what are you struggling with your screen time, or what do you see happening on social media? And once we say, we want to hear from you, then they care, as opposed to what I see so often is this message of zero tolerance. Let's just take everything away and get mad at you. That's not going to get kids to open up and feel comfortable to be a part of this. And that's really what this is going to take.
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm William Brangham in Washington, D.C.